Henry V, the prayer, O God of battle, steel my soldier's heart. Possess them not with fear. Take from them now the sense of reckoning which my father gave. Not today, O Lord, not today.
Oh my God.
Put that to music.
Oh. This is John McEuen, and you're on the Americana Music Show. And today, I'm going to venture a little bit away from music and go to somebody that loves music and somebody you might recognize from his films of Clockwork Orange and beyond. The great Malcolm McDowell. I went to his house in Ojai and wanted to visit with him. I wanted to actually want to find out what he thought about the new album, The McEuen Sessions, that I did with my two sons, Nathan and Jonathan McEuen, that has come out this year. And here's Malcolm just talking about music and acting and his past. A conversation with Malcolm McDowell. We're here visiting with Malcolm McDowell, a name that anybody that knows movies knows, and a face that people are afraid of. Is that right, Malcolm?
My wife, especially, yeah, my kids. So,
Well, you are a big fan of Jonathan McEuen, you tell me.
And I am. We live in the same town. I've seen the development of Jonathan, and from the moment I saw him in a little coffee house, you know, in town, just playing with the thriving three of them playing, and he just has something which is special, and. He has a terrific voice, you know, and he can really play that guitar of his. And he's something. And of course, knowing his lineage, I'm not surprised, because the apple does not fall far from the tree, as they say, and that is true. And that's what I love about this album, that you worked with him. So, and I think you told me this, and it all makes sense, that, you know, that Jonathan played with you when he was a teenager and young, and then you threw him out of the nest and said, get thee gone.
Well, I've worked, put him on stage from the time he was six, and then more at 11 and 12 and 13, and he wanted a guitar, and he got one, but I said, you need to buy your own guitar. Right. I'll help you with it, but you got to pay me back, because you have to own it. I don't want you playing my guitar. And he did that at 15, got a Strat.
Wow.
And then around 24 or 5, I said, you're fired. It was one of the toughest days of my life. And I said, well, what's the matter? I said, well, every show you do for me is one less for you.
Well, you know, that's so smart. It's so smart. Of course, it must have been difficult and a weird decision, but it's made him assume an identity of Jonathan. Not just copying his dad or riding on your coattails, but he's found his own voice. And I love the fact that years later you've come back and made this album and helped him out, because that's what parents do, A. And B, it's an incredible music extravaganza for us, the listener. And the album is really beautiful. It's the best work he's ever done.
Oh,
I think, and I'm sure you're very proud of it too.
I'm proud of the fact that they came to the mark, that we decided, the layout was each person pick three songs, and then we'll vote on three that we have to agree on. But as for the three you pick, we're going to play them, whatever the other two were.
Yeah, you know? That's great. That's
and
great.
And it was really fun in that regard. And what I'm proud of is, if I was going to go hire musicians to make music like this, I would have wanted to hire them.
Wow, yeah, that's beautiful.
You know, and it's
well, fantastic. It shows, and you can hear it. It's
what is it about it? You made such. I wanted people to hear what Malcolm McDowell had to say about an album we're very proud of. But
you know, I I'm not a good critic. Of anything, really. I know what I like and what I don't like. And just playing this in the car really it made me really listen to it in a way that, you know, I listened to Van Morrison. And that, to me, is the highest compliment.
But see, you say you're not a critic, but that's the most important critic to me.
It's in my car, and I play it a lot. So, you know, every track is fabulous. You are very tight as a group. It seems that, you know, it seems like you've been playing together forever. All I'll say is that it's just a fantastic listen, I would thoroughly recommend it to anybody.
I hope you catch us on stage, because we do things.
I will.
You know, I don't know if we're any good in the big picture, but for what we do together, we're better at it than we've ever been, and it is so much fun.
That's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And you know, you can't say fairer than that. And the marvelous thing about careers, and we're, I presume, roughly the same age, is that, you know, careers come and go, there's peaks, there's valleys, but the truly good ones will always be there. You know, you will always work, you'll always have an audience, and
we hope, I hope.
I know you will, because class is class, and that's that, you know, and hopefully some of that will rub off on Jonathan. Once he starts to get the idea that, you know, that music or any art form, acting, painting, directing, whatever it is, writing, is a discipline. It is a discipline.
He is good at that. And yeah. It's funny you say that, because the conversation in the car on the way up here was, I had a 12-hour session the other day, and one guy didn't show up, and another guy, it was like, these people don't realize how important, it was like, he's, in the last several years, become...
Yeah,
aware of how important that is.
I think that may have been the missing element, you know, because I think that when you're young, and he's very young, Jonathan's a young kid, you know, but, you know, that goes fast too. And so I'm really, at this culmination of everything, I think this is where he with your guidance...
You know, you mentioned Van Morrison earlier. Well, Malcolm McDowell has been a known actor, but what are the musical things in your background that reached you?
Well, you know, funnily enough, I started at school doing musical comedies, and I thought that I would be a musical comedy actor, you know. I was rather shocked when, you know, it's luck, good luck, or bad luck, whatever it is.
This is in England,
when I first started.
In Beer Hall, the funny songs of Ian Whitcomb type, maybe?
Yes, exactly. Or, you know, character songs and stuff like from My Fair Lady, you know, that kind of stuff.
Did you know Benny Hill?
No, I never met Benny Hill. But that kind of thing. Not quite. It's more musicals, Broadway musicals. And, you know, I was good at doing the comedy side of it, and maybe I didn't have a great voice, but I could sell a song, which is a whole different thing.
You know? 11. What age did you know that you wanted to be on stage?
That then, because you go onto a stage, there's a void, and just bright lights that hit you, and you look out, and there's this black void, and you either feel at home or you don't. And I thought, I'm totally relaxed. I didn't think it, I just was. And on all the other kids, I were fearsome. They were so, you know, I was nervous before I went on, but as soon as I got out there, it was like home.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, and you get the energy from the audience. You know, they give you the energy, and it's incredible. Of course, in film, you don't get that, but you have to manufacture that yourself.
The first film was?
The first film was a great one called If, directed by Lindsay Anderson in 1968, and it won the grand prize at the Cannes Film Festival in 1969.
Wow.
It's a great film, a great film.
At what age were you?
I was 23.
Did that go to your head? Was that a big... Was it Malcolm McDowell's hard to talk to now?
No, because Lindsay Anderson was the star. He was the director, and he was an auteur. He was an extraordinary mentor to me. And he wouldn't ever countenance, you know, giving a big head or anything. And then I had these great movies in succession, you know. And it was a time of great movies and a great movement. And you'll remember it, you know, there was the great anti-war movement. Mm-hmm. And everything, every weekend there was some demonstration about something.
At what, you were talking about 67, 68?
Yes, exactly, 67, 68, 69.
That first film, was that a comedy?
No, it was about a revolution in a boys' school.
Did you feel at the time that you were now away from comedy?
No, the funny thing is, even though I do these, I've always done these really heavy roles, mm-hmm. I always look for the comedy in it. And I think this is confusing to people because I play these badass characters who are, in a very black way, very funny. And Clockwork Orange is a good example, you know.
And what number film was it in this line of?
That was number 4. So it's an extraordinary piece of writing, that. So that helps the actor enormously when he's got something great, you know, to say, written by a really brilliant novelist, Anthony Burgess.
Yes.
The book, you know.
Well, with this background and love of comedy, when you got to some of these serious roles, were you ever improvisational?
All the time. Usually I do what they ask me to do, and then if they leave it running at the end, I will
elucidate on what?
My whole other side of it. And sometimes that can be very funny, and sometimes they keep it in. Sometimes it's the whole performance.
Is there one in particular proud moment where you said, I think this line will fit here, and it did?
Well, I mean, a marked one is that, you know, me just singing in the rain with Kubrick.
Oh, right, yes.
And that wasn't in the script, you know, and I just improvised this singing in the rain because, you know, the character was so euphoric, and Hollywood has shown us euphoric moments in this beautiful musical with Gene Kelly, and So singing in the rain became a key point in the movie, you know, and actually, yes, that there's lots of, so many instances where I've gone off book, and in practically everything I do. I'm just about to embark on a project I've had in the works for 20 odd years.
You mentioned peaks and valleys earlier of a career.
Yeah.
Where are you now?
Well, I'm sort of halfway up the peak again, another peak. It's been a valley for a while, but in the last few years, it's sort of beginning to rise. It's not so much exciting, and you know, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, I don't care. You know, it's like, okay, well, let's enjoy every moment this time.
Uh-huh.
And I really do. I love it. I have so much fun when I work. You know, it's mostly the work, not the all bullshit parties, publicity, and all that. That is really boring. It always was.
Uh-huh.
And I think Kelly thought it was going to be lots of fun at the Vanity Fair party, but our feet hurt so badly we couldn't wait to get home.
And Kelly is?
My wife.
Well, maybe people listening don't know that. Oh. I thought.
Well, they know now.
Yeah, they do. Music in your life. Mm. You mentioned musical comedy. Did you play anything?
Well, look, you know, no. I wish to God I could play an instrument. I envy you guys. I think it's unfair that you can pick up a guitar, a banjo, or whatever the instrument, a piano, and sit down and just play. And my mother could play piano, but it was sort of, she had to read the music, you know. She mm-hmm. couldn't just do it. And then there were kids at school my age who could sit down on a piano stool. And just,
at what time in your life?
When I was, you know, a young man, you know. Mm-hmm. Just, there was one particular kid who was a wonderful pianist. Mm-hmm. And he could transform things and play boogie woogie and all this kind of stuff. And it was just amazing gift to have.
So you have an appreciation for music that goes deep into a lot of styles. You mentioned Van Morrison. Who else?
He's a very influential Van to me. I did a film, the follow-up film to If, with the same director, was called Oh Lucky Man.
Oh, yeah.
And the music for Oh Lucky Man was done by a wonderful singer called Alan Price, who, Alan was one of the original Animals who did House of the Rising Sun, mm-hmm. you know, Eric Burdon, great voice, but Alan did all the arrangements and he did the organ on that. That's extraordinary. He's a wonderful singer. And he did the music for Oh Lucky Man and appeared in the movie. It's like a Greek chorus, and it's a fantastic music. It really is. So Alan, I've always followed Alan. I've always loved Randy Newman, people like this, you know. And I remember when I came to America first for Clockwork Orange.
What year?
It was 71.
Mm-hmm.
The most fun thing they did to me was they took me over to the music, Warner's music, because the soundtrack for Clockwork went golden, you know.
Wow.
Which was the first time I think music from a movie had done that. It was huge,
mm-hmm.
the soundtrack. And they took me into a room that was just completely all shelves full of albums and just said, help yourself.
And you got to pick out anything
you want. I got to, you know, pick out the most extraordinary stuff. And, this is where I first heard Fleetwood Mac and, you know, just J.J. Cale, people like that, that you know, we didn't know really that well in England. Fleetwood Mac, yes, of course, but not J.J. Cale.
You mentioned your roles earlier. Do you feel like it works against you sometimes?
Well, you know, it's a double-edged sword, you know, and it's something you have to live with. And at the end of the day, I think if there's putting you in a pigeonhole, it's not a bad thing. Because it means you've made your mark in one particular thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, better to make your mark in something than not at all. It can be limiting, but then when you do get the chance to show the other side of you, I think people are more amazed. So I remember once they were considering me for some sitcom on television, and the producer, writer, called my agent and said, oh, can he do comedy? Which was relayed to me, and I had the same reaction. I said, well, call him back and say, can you write it?
Did it happen? Did you?
Yeah, I did.
Did you have to audition for it?
No. They had a reading, and I went to the reading with the whole cast,
mm-hmm.
and it was evident, and they came running with me into the parking lot, you know, because I hadn't signed for it.
Mm-hmm.
And the director said, you better get him, you know, quick. I learned this afterwards.
Uh-huh.
And so that was nice, and I had a lot of fun doing that.
In general, because people, and me myself sometimes, I know how it happens mm-hmm. sometimes, but do you go for parts, or do parts come to you and you choose out of the five scripts your agent sends, I'll take number three? Or do you have that happen?
No. It doesn't usually happen like that. It's usually, you know, the part, I never go after a part.
Mm-hmm.
I never do. I suppose that's the English in me. I just feel it's undignified. If they want you, they want you. If they don't. But I think that, I don't think there's any part that I've actually gone after. They usually find me at some point, you know, and for instance, there's a part here that I'm going to do in May in New York with Olympia Dukakis. Now, this was offered to me 2 years ago with Olympia, who I am a great fan of, and she's a wonderful actress, and I read it, and, you know, there was no money then, there's no money now, but I figure, you know what, it's such a good piece of writing, mm-hmm. such a wonderful actress, and she's so committed to it, she's not being paid anything, then screw it, I'll do it, because it'll be fun, you know, it will be.
In my 45 years in the music business, I can say there's five things that stand out at the top of my list of things that I've been involved in.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a situation like that with you? Are there a certain number of films that...
Well, of course there are.
Because some actors go, I never look at the film. I never seen it. I did that movie, I didn't watch it. And I never got
well,
that.
Well, some movies that are like that. But For instance, I had a small role in the Oscar-winning movie this year.
Yes, I saw it. Yeah.
And I had a tiny bit, but even so, I was so glad to be part of that because it's such a sort of anomaly, to have a silent black and white movie that the French made. But it just appealed to my sense of humor, that.
No.
And for them to come to Hollywood to shoot it, when most films in Hollywood, they leave immediately to find somewhere cheaper. I thought, the balls of these French to come here to do a movie about the silent movie era, about America.
Why didn't Hollywood think of it?
Well, of course, it's too obvious, for Hollywood. And it also amused me to think that if they brought the script and tried to raise the money, get out of town, Frenchie, there's no way. So it was fun from that point of view.
But did you feel when you were working on The Artist that it was going to be special, unusual? Like when people did Wizard of Oz, they thought, oh, this is a piece of whatever, let's get it over with.
Right.
Did The Artist have that feeling of...
Well, it did, only because it was a silent movie. Mm-hmm. And that you're never asked to do a silent movie. So it was beautiful. I was going to play another part in it, but I couldn't because of a conflict. And so they said, well, will you just come down and we'll give you lunch and just do a scene? I went, absolutely. I'll be happy to do that.
Cool.
So I suppose for me, the first movie is very important because it started it all off. It led to Kubrick and Clockwork Orange. And I think memorable things for me are performances I've done on stage because there's a continuity about that and an immediacy that you get from the audience. Mm-hmm. So, and you work on it. You don't work on it fragment by fragment. You work on it as a whole piece. And so it sticks in the memory more, I remember scenes I did in Clockwork, but I couldn't put it all together as a performance, only fragments of it, because it was on film, of course, and shot out of content, out of, it wasn't shot continuity.
Continuity, yeah.
So, in fact, we shot the end pretty much at the beginning, I think after a week or two, and we shot... Well, I shot on that movie for, I think, 8 or 9 months. It was a long shoot.
Did it feel like it was making new ground? Can you remember?
I just felt that it was, something extraordinary about it, but I didn't know whether people would accept it or not. I thought they probably would because Kubrick was the world's most successful director, being not only an art house director, but also one who made money, which was very rare. Mm-hmm. He was the Steven Spielberg of his day, if you like. So that, Kubrick had done 2001. He'd done Dr. Strangelove, Lolita, and all these great movies, So when I worked with him, he was on a real high, and great things were expected. So that it was a lot of fun for me because he really let me get on with it. He had no idea about actors or acting or anything. He didn't want to know. He wasn't interested, So, so anyway, it was a big thing, of course.
What is it that you've seen all these movies? How many have you done? 40? How many films have you done?
Over 100.
Oh, my God. I'm sorry. I apologize.
No, don't. Don't even... try and get the track of how many. I think I did 4 last year. I'm doing 3 this year that I know of. No, 4. I did one earlier.
And you feel like you're on the way up to a new peak? I know exactly what you mean. The nitty-gritty dirt band. We've had, I tell people, our career's kind of like a saw blade.
Well, there you are. Isn't that beautiful, though? Because, when it happens at first, you're so... Well, at least I was sort of intimidated by it because it was so overwhelming, and I'm from England, so things in England are a little more measured and a little more relaxed, You star in a movie, big deal.
That's your profession, that's your job, you did
it. If you've done played Hamlet at with the Royal Shakespeare Company, now that is a big deal. That kind of attitude. So that, you know, the movies that I did transcended the sort of boundaries of England and came to America in a very big way. So, and you know, in America they love celebrity, they love all that way more than they do in Europe. And that was overwhelming, you know, at first.
Well, since you're implied or said you're on a peak,
right,
heading up.
Well, heading up.
Is there something out of all these years that you want to make? You're making everybody else's stuff. Is there a particular...
Yes, well, there is this one I was telling you about that I'm going to do this summer that's called The Monster Butler, and it is sort of like Clockwork Orange 40 years on.
Hmm.
And it's a script that I've had a long time. We've done so many versions of it. And it's based on a true story, or the true life of this man who was a con man, a brilliant con man.
Set in?
Set in England, Scotland.
That time period?
It's contemporary. I mean, we're going to do it contemporary because it's another $3 million to make it period, 80s. So forget about that. We don't. I don't care what the cars look like.
Uh-huh. It's a content.
Yeah, exactly. So... It's, you know, he was an extraordinary guy by all accounts, and he could have been a politician, a captain of industry, but he went down this path of being a con man, a thief, and in his later years, a serial killer.
Oh my God. I can see now where you fit in.
So we're revisiting old territory, but not really. It's a black comedy,
mm-hmm,
which scares financiers to death.
It's a wonderful thing. It's like in Pulp Fiction. You're laughing when somebody's getting shot.
Exactly.
Oh my God! They blew his head off in the car.
They're talking about a Big Mac, and you know, in Paris, and they're talking about a Big Mac. I mean, it's hilarious.
Yeah.
And you know, if you can pull that off,
that's a magic combination.
It's magic. It is.
For those listening, it's considered. At least maybe it's changed, but it takes an average of 7 years to get an idea to the screen.
Mm-hmm.
And some people, Million Dollar Baby, took Clint Eastwood 14 years.
Well,
took Clint Eastwood 14 years, yeah, to get the money, the studio, everybody behind it, because he could have made it, but he needed everybody behind it.
Right.
And
right.
How long has this project been on your desk?
Well, it was actually the book of this guy's life. It was given to me by Lindsay before he died. He died in...
Your first director.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my God!
And he said, "This is a part you must play." So it's had a life of its own, and you know, as you say, I could have pushed it and done it, but I laid off it and decided to let it find its own life.
Mm-hmm.
And it did, and it did. This young director came to me and asked me if he could direct it, because he knew I owned the script and he read the script.
Did you write the script?
No, I didn't write it. A friend of mine who lives in Ojai wrote it, Peter, mm-hmm, Bellwood. And Peter's an old friend, so he wrote it. I mean, he knew what was required and stuff. And then it was, you know, he rewrote it to suit everybody.
Over how long of a period?
Well, I think he wrote it in 2001, the script. But I've had the book since, mm-hmm, since 1990, I think.
Is a screenplay written yet?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We're ready to go. We're interviewing people now. We're getting...
Can you define for... It would be a wonderful thing from Malcolm McDowell to hear you define the difference between story, script, and screenplay.
Well, the shooting script is... We're as fine a script as... You know, it's been rewritten and we've eliminated stuff that's not important. We've come down to the bare essentials of what the script is, what the character is, what's needed, because everything is so damned expensive, so we've been forced to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, and actually it's not a bad thing. You know, if we can't afford to do a big set scene, then I will just look at the camera and talk. and we'll get over it that way and tell a joke.
Let whatever. The power of the words work.
Or just this incredible guy, you know, who would walk into a pub and within 10 minutes have 30 people listening to every word that he had to say, because he regaled them with such you know, great stories and all the rest of it. Completely, of course, most of them untrue, but it didn't really matter.
I spend 22 hours of my day when I'm doing a show.
Yeah.
Going out, and I get excited in that last hour. My wife, my kids, they know it's not the time to bring up something because I'm worried about what's. I use a bunch of instruments or into, and I get that feeling of I can't wait to get on to do this. Mm-hmm. When you have these roles, when is it you get the? Are you? Is it the day of shooting? Is it during makeup? Is it the week before?
It's really. It's actually when I first walk onto the set because.
You're fired up.
I literally have to forget about it. You know, I have to forget about it, and I read the script over and over, over and over. I don't want to learn it too well because I want to be very loose. I want to be able to decide to go in another direction. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be, you know, blinkered about my thoughts. So I want to be keep it loose and just go with it.
Mm.
But have something to fall back on if there's nothing happens. And often, and that will happen. Nothing will happen and you'll just go, hey, what's in the script? Let's do that. You know, there's nothing better than that. But I don't really get fired up till I walk onto the set and start, you know, and start rehearsing. And then I start to really enjoy and find it and, you know, get to really relish it. And, you know, the thing is, you have to love what you do, like you do. You love it, and the audience pick up on that. I love it, and they pick up, because there's a light goes off behind the eyes.
You do it in a way that you take them somewhere out of their world.
Yes.
Into yours.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And to me, that's the difference between a great comic who goes up and tells jokes and a comedian humorist like Bill Cosby brings you into his life.
That's it.
You know, you go to a Cosby show and all of a sudden you're living in his house after about 10 minutes.
Yeah, that's right, absolutely, and he's brilliant at that. And all these great ones do that, don't they?
Yeah.
It's not just jokes. I know, it's true.
I was having, I did the music for a Tommy Lee Jones film. It was wonderful. I lived with him for a month in Texas.
Yeah.
And one night around 2 in the morning, he starts talking about, and we're sitting, he starts talking about, the napalm was coming in, and it just said, and on, the bombs were going off. And he went on about 5 minutes. And I said, I didn't know you went to Vietnam. He goes, oh, that's from heaven and earth.
Yeah.
He was going through one of his favorite speeches in the movie.
Wow.
Do you ever have lines like that or things that you feel like you think about?
Occasionally. To be honest with you, I've done so much work.
Yes.
That I don't have any room left in the memory bank. I mean, I will do a scene, come off, if they say print, I'll go sit down, have a cup of tea, and if they say, oh, sorry, you'll have to come and redo that, and I'm going, give me the script because I have forgotten it. I mean, literally, it's wiped.
Wow.
And it has to be that way, but otherwise I would have so much crap in my mind. And the weird thing is, I remember pieces of Shakespeare I learned as a boy.
Wow.
That's weird.
Why did you learn Shakespeare as a boy?
I was made to at school. You have to learn this, you know. And so I'd work on it, learn it.
Alas for Yorick, etc.?
Yes, I mean, certain things, or parts that I played at school. I remember those.
What's one of them?
Gratiano in The Merchant of Venice.
Uh-huh.
I come no more to make you laugh. Or speak, that's Hamlet. Well, now you put me on the spot.
Well, you can get off the spot if you want.
Yeah,
but it's just
but
interesting.
Things, or a piece of Henry V, the prayer, O God of battle, steal my soldiers' heart. Possess them not with fear. Take from them now the sense of reckoning which my father gave. Not today, O Lord, not today.
Oh, my God.
Put that to music.
Oh, that's wonderful. We've been visiting with Malcolm McDowell. If you don't know who he is, you should. And if you do, you've been enthralled as I have been.
Great to talk to you, John.
Thank you, Malcolm.
All the best.
And we've been visiting with Malcolm McDowell here on the Americana Music Show at his home in Ojai, California. He works out of there, driving up to Hollywood sometimes every day, and goes all over the world in that wonderful path of his career, over 100 films. Check us out. Thanks for tuning in. This is John McEuen.
Tough, I don't think I've said I love you near enough. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old. His blood runs through my instrument and the song is in my soul. Life has been a poor attempt imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the need.